All right, let's go back then to Soweto, where our reporter Ntata Katlani is with the Al Jamaa Party, which is launching their manifesto this afternoon. Good afternoon once again to you, Ntata. Apologies, I think we had some problems with our sound there. You were having a conversation with the Al Jamaa representatives, and I do believe that the manifesto is currently underway at this point.
So happy birthday, Raisha. All protocol observed. After acknowledging the birthdays, but I'm also proud to have my son Ismail here sitting in front on my chair. I think he wants to be the next president of Al Jamaa. Ismail, please stand up. Thank you. Girls, Ismail is married. He is married. And he's married to a banker. You can never beat a banker. Our national spokesperson mentioned that in 2002 I got an award as a pioneer of the internet. I introduced online shopping, online banking. Under my leadership, online media. Media 24 was born out of my hands. There was no Media 24. Then we had Twitter. We had WhatsApp, we had emails, we had Instagram. So if it wasn't for me and it wasn't for Al Jamaa, you would have had no WhatsApp. You would have had no Twitter. So thank you very much. Say thank you, Al Jamaa. Thank you, Al Jamaa. Viva Al Jamaa. But now Al Jamaa wants to move you into the cyber civilization. You know that they talk about the fourth industrial revolution. But do you know what was the first revolution? The first revolution was coal and steam. Write it down. The second revolution was electricity, which the city of Cape Town charges so much the poor people can't afford electricity. The third revolution was digitalization. Online stuff, and all our municipalities are far behind. There must be free data, there must be free internet. That is the first step to freedom in the cyber civilization. And Al Jamaa will ensure in the municipalities that it will co-govern, that there will be free data and free internet. By denying the young people of South Africa free internet and free data, it is as bad as apartheid. We can't have apartheid after 27 years of democratic rule. We have to free the internet. We have to free data. Then that's the first step to freedom. So we don't have freedom. Al Jamaa gives a clear message to the DA and other political parties that where we will govern or co-govern, we will get things done better. Not just get things done for the benefit of white people. Where we will govern, we will get things done better. Yes, we got things done better, like the DA, when we started to co-govern the city of Gaul, city of Johannesburg. Our MMC Imam Tapelo Ahmed from Soweto, we heard earlier on from the trade union, he got things done better. Not like the DA, you see their posters, we get things done for the benefit of the whites. Imam Council of the Palo made things happen. And I just list a few: making development planning accessible to the people. The city of Johannesburg has now approved a green building policy. You must see the green building policies in Singapore. It reduces climate change. And here in South Africa, we die because nothing is being done about climate change. In Khayelitsha, 1 million residents are slowly poisoned by the DA because they pollute the waterways. When the DA ruled the city of Johannesburg, they refused to approve the Southern Farms mega project, and neither did they want to approve the Lanceria Smart City Presidential project. Yes, we want a smart city, but Al Jamaa wants smart wards, smart voting stations, smart rural villages. Because I got the award as a pioneer of the internet, and I'm dabbling in the already we're dabbling in the fifth industrial revolution. We are catching up on the fourth industrial revolution. And in Mapami village near Umtata, where they have an ocean and they have a forest. Now the white people don't know about it, otherwise they would have already captured that ocean and captured that forest. I hope no whites are listening, otherwise they will go out, the developers, and capture that. We've given that rural village, through our efforts, a fishing village so they can go deeper into the ocean and catch nice big fish. And we're going to convert that rural village with the help of the royal house into a smart village. So Al Jamaa want to start with smart villages, smart voting stations, smart wards. Then we can talk about Lanceria and the presidential project. The president wants to give us a model and we support him. With the weight of Al Jamaa's MMC on the council and his ward councillor Imran Wursa, the party did further work to make things happen in the city of Johannesburg. We launched the I Am the Future initiative, and we are setting up a property and construction chamber in Soweto. When it comes to property, the expert in South Africa, and I don't want to brag because he's related to me, is my son Ismail, and he's sitting there quietly. He should be telling us about how we are going to mobilize the 100 billion rand of property that the city of Johannesburg owns, but they tell the ratepayers, it's only worth 1 billion, but it is worth 100 billion rand. Just imagine if that property is shared amongst all of us. We will have housing, we'll have businesses, we'll have manufacturing plants. So Al Jamaa has showed South Africa what an MMC must do. And Councillor Imam Tapelo from Soweto has set an example that no other MMC in any other municipality can meet. But let me not just speak about him. We also have Councillor Imran Wursa, who slaughtered the ANC and the DA in the last by-election and won the ward for the first time. Councillor Imran Wursa is a beloved councillor. The only beloved councillor in South Africa. Have you heard of any other beloved councillor? And his achievements as a ward councillor is textbook. Every ward councillor can learn from Councillor Imran Wursa. And then amongst many of you here, we have aspirant councillors. We have the best aspirant council contesting the November 1st elections. And we're going to surprise South Africa. We're going to have councillors that will have the balance of power in six municipalities. And when the DA or the ANC and the EFF tells us, please give our seat so that we can have the majority, we will tell them, yes, get our seats, but give us the mayoral chain. We're not going to give you the seats because we are here to co-govern. And if you want our seats, even if it's one seat, give us the mayoral chain. In the city of Cape Town, I've been deployed from Parliament to be the mayoral candidate. And I've already contacted the speaker's office to say, look, that chain is too heavy, make me a lighter chain. So when I walk around with my chain, it is not a chain around my neck, but it's a chain for liberation. In the city of Cape Town, we have a city of three cities. How can they have it? I know many of you read the Tale of Two Cities, Charles Dickens. But in Cape Town, they're very unique. Those whites running the city, sharing power without losing control. They've got a white special precinct with leafy and beachy suburbs. Clifton, Camps Bay, Muizenberg, Llandudno. That's white language. We don't know that language. We don't know those places. Just kept for whites. Then we have a second city, 300 sewage infested informal settlements. And each time the white people pull their chain off their toilet, that sewage goes in waterways and slow poisons 1 million people in Khayelitsha, and they don't even realize that they're being slowly poisoned. So the second city, they're using slow poisoning to get rid of the second city. And then the third city are our suburbs on the Cape Flats. You met our sister earlier on, and she complained to me about the issue of housing and not having a marriage certificate. She comes from the Cape Flats. She knows how miserable it is to live on the Cape Flats. So as far as the Cape Flats is concerned, the mayor is not in charge. When I become mayor, I will be in charge of those suburbs. Because at the moment, the mayor doesn't run the Cape Flats areas. The premier, the DA premier, doesn't run the Cape Flats areas. Even President Ramaphosa doesn't run those areas. It is run by gangsters. So Altama will make sure that for the first time after 27 years, that part of South Africa will not be run, will be run by those democratically elected to do so. I want to talk about the deal that was made after the Freedom Charter year and at CODESA. In order to get going, we know about Chris Hani that was murdered. The whites said that we will not sign this agreement for freedom, for a non-violent freedom, unless there's an opportunity for the Western Cape to have a referendum, break away and have their own country. In KZN, there was also a group, I don't want to mention their name because I respect their leader. They also said that KZN must have opportunity to have a referendum and be a country on its own. Just imagine, in Cape Town, there are political parties asking for a Cape exit, like they had a Brexit for Britain to move away from the European Union. How can you campaign on a ticket calling for a breakaway of the Western Cape? And that means you are a traitor. It is treason. You can't swear to the constitution for one unified South Africa and then campaign that you want to break away. So the tactics that the DA and their surrogate parties use, they've tried it in two elections. This is the third election. And for the first time, they call it a Cape exit. The Cape wants to exit from South Africa. So we are calling on the people of Johannesburg. And I will make that call in Cape Town. Please don't allow the whites to break South Africa into three countries. KZN one country, Western Cape one country, and the rest of us another country. I went to the IEC pledge ceremony to pledge a free and fair election. And I stayed at the hotel, and there were some shops around there that were selling, and there's a red jersey that I liked, the same color as that sister with the red skirt there. I liked that color, and I went to buy the red jersey. And he asked me, "Where are you from?" And I said, "I'm from Cape Town." He said, my friend, I'm also from Cape Town. Please don't leave Cape Town. Very soon you will be your own country." He was obviously a Jewish person. So the word has spread to Johannesburg already that Cape Town wants to be a white country, and they'll have some colors and Africans, you know, that are all sellouts like we had in the Cameral Parliament. All sellouts. But because of Kodesa, they were saved. We still have a lot of these sellouts in Parliament, in our municipalities. But happily, many of them have died and may their souls rest in peace. Let's wish the dead well. We can't have break South Africa up into three countries. And the Johannesburg whites are already planning to get passports and visas to live in that particular new Western Cape government. Let's talk about African values. Al-Jamaa believes in the United States of Africa. There must be no borders. Yes, I know you're worried about jobs being taken by other African people, but think of your children. We want a borderless Africa. It's the white colonialists that broke us into different countries. Africa was one country, one continent. So many of us, we jumped very high when we heard this Uhuru, freedom, independence. But that Uhuru, even in South Africa, is a fake freedom. African countries on its own can't compete with the European Union, can't compete with the United States of America. But a United States of Africa with all the countries combined, we will beat them. We will slaughter America. We will slaughter the European Union in terms of development, in terms of agricultural expertise, and if we have a United States of Africa, Africa will be the breadbasket of the world. But they're holding us back. And you find that there are 10 countries that France gave freedom. But those 10 countries pay extortion money every month to France. Extortion money. They pay 40% of their revenue and taxes to France, which is extortion. And no one says anything about it. And France controls the banking system. So every month they make sure the debit goes through to the coffers of France. I don't want to go into that. But you see, the problem is we are electing judges. We are electing a chief justice. But no one makes the cut. Why don't they all make the cut? And even our sitting judges on the Constitutional Court, I'm not in Parliament, so I don't have indemnity. But let me say it. Those judges sitting on the Constitutional Court, in the High Court, in the Appeal Court, they use European jurisprudence, not African jurisprudence. How can you come right if you use European standards, European jurisprudence? When it comes to sentencing, there's Ubuntu. When we sentence a person that has done something wrong, Ubuntu comes in. But they've killed Ubuntu. Our legal eagles, our judges, and I'm sorry, my press, national spokesperson is also a legal eagle. She was a judge in the family court. She's the exception. The rest, they don't practice African values and African jurisprudence. So when you sentence an old man of 80, you don't pacify the whites and the European jurisprudence. You use Ubuntu. You take into account the person's age. And that's why, Adama was criticized, we call for a pardon of President Zuma because of his age. Because he was a former president. Because he prevented the civil war in KZN. I was there with Harry Gwala. And I saw the good work he did. And Harry Gwala used to tell me, this is our man. He's prevented the civil war. Now, do you send such a person to jail in the coldest part of South Africa, Escort? I know Escort. I work there. We have a deputy. Altama is a deputy mayor in Escort. It's the coldest place in the world, and they sent the former president there to try and get him to die of cold. So we called for a pardon, and we made the application to the minister. And then when we saw that the president was very ill, we called for medical parole, and the pressure on President Ramaphosa was so much after Al-Zama raised it in parliament that in 3 days' time we got medical parole. And we wish him a speedy recovery. A speedy recovery so he can face the charges against him. You can't charge a person and put him in court if he's not fit to defend himself. Let's give President Zuma a chance to recover and go to court and defend himself. And if he's guilty, he's guilty. So I spoke to quite a few African ambassadors and I told him, let's assume President Zuma is guilty. What must happen? Must he serve the 15 years in jail? They said, no, that's not the African way. The African way is his peers will speak to him and they will come to an agreement what's the best way to punish him. Because if he's guilty, he must be punished. You can't get away free, but an African punishment, not a European punishment. Today, the African women still bear the brunt of inequalities in South Africa, the most unequal country in the world, only matched by the DA city of Cape Town. I already said that this city is known as the drunk city of the world. Alcohol trading hours, they increased to 22. You can drink yourself to death for 22 hours. Now, I know some of you may now want to come to Cape Town. But increasing alcohol trading hours increases alcohol harm. And the reason they want us to be drunk is so that we can't fight for our real liberation. Robert Sobukwe, who was a senior member of the ANC at the time, I know he later on formed his own party, told the cadres, don't drink alcohol when you come to NEC meetings and conferences and weekends. You know what happens during weekends when the youth leagues of different parties and the NECs meet. Hulle syp hulle dronk, soos hulle sê in die Kaap. Robert Sobukwe was against that. We've seen with COVID what alcohol does. And in Cape Town they had a dope system, and the trade union will support me, that people were paid with bottles of wine so that over the weekend they are drunk and on Monday they come to work and they work as slaves. So the DA wants that dope system to carry on when they form their own country. Under the pretext that it's a Cape exit. They want to enslave coloureds and Indians and Africans. And already the whites in Joburg, the whites at Gold Reef City, are preparing to come to that white province. But we were very clever when we wrote the constitution. The clauses allowing a referendum, we clouded it. So it's not very clear, which means that legislation must be passed to understand the constitution, allowing for those two countries to break away for the sake of our liberation. We had to give in. But now there has to be a legislation, and then as long as Al-Zama and a Liberation Movement Party co-governs, we'll make sure that that is a pipe dream. That person at Gold Reef City, he will die. And when he dies, there won't be another country that his soul can go to his soul will stay in South Africa. Now I want to talk to you about the biggest corruption that's happening in South Africa under your eyes. And that is the hourly rate. Now I know the unions don't like the hourly rate. They want a full month salary, comrade. But the DA negotiates an hourly rate with consultants. And they triple the price. And secondly, they inflate the work that has to be done. Now, when it comes to consultant work, there's no oversight. It's a statement which a consultant sends to the CEO. And that CEO in the city of Cape Town, just to give you an example, I read in the press, he approved it without any oversight. The mayor didn't even have a say. He could just approve left, right and center the invoices from consultants. And in this way, 75 billion rand was spent on consultants. And that CEO who signed off on the invoices, he has now been offered a job in a top company and shareholding because of the hours that he signed off for them over the last 10 years when the DA ruled Cape Town. So one of the things that we need to ban, I know South Africans, like Don Matera said, we don't like banning. He told his sisters, you know, hey, they're going to ban you, hide away, don't let them catch you. But hourly pay for consultants must be banned. It must not be allowed because they charge 10 times the price, and that work can be done by officials at a very cheap price. So that's where our money is going. The biggest looting in all our municipalities, and I don't want to talk about the province and parliament, that's another story. That we leave to the Zondo Commission. But the biggest looters are the DA-controlled municipalities where they use hourly rate to steal the money. Now, they are experts because during apartheid, they stole more than the ANC did than other political parties. The ANC must learn from the whites and the DA how to be corrupt and how to loot and to steal. They are just stealing the crumbs. The white man knows how to steal using these hourly consultants. So Al-Jamaa, when we co-govern six of the municipalities, we take a small start. I know there's 2,000 municipalities. We just want to co-govern six. We want to co-govern the city of Johannesburg, where MMC Tapelo is doing a great job. And the citizens of Johannesburg will benefit from his dedication. And when it comes to ward work, we've got Councillor Imran Mursa, who set the standards for the rest of the country. Our beloved councillor, the only beloved councillor in South Africa. Okay, I want to conclude by talking about service delivery. Every mayor, every political party has come to the voters and say that we will provide service delivery. And service delivery, and everyone has got service delivery on their lips. But service delivery, the way it happens in South Africa, is akin to oppression. Now you will say, Al-Jamaa, what's wrong with you? You're saying that service delivery is oppression. We want service delivery. But Al-Jamaa is saying, and we are live on many TV stations, we are saying, downward service delivery, downward service delivery, downward service delivery. If you go to the Freedom Charter, this is one of the clauses that was voted on and approved where we stand. Where you stand. People put up their hands. And what did they vote for? I think in their hearts they wanted to vote for Al-Jamaa, but we weren't around yet. But they voted, the people must govern. The people after 27 years in South Africa are not governing. And that means our freedom is fake. And I can see some of the spirits of those who are involved in the Freedom Charter sitting next to you, trying to pacify you, trying to motivate you, and telling you, please, man, implement the Freedom Charter. Not one clause of the Freedom Charter has been implemented. The clauses in the Constitution to bring about transformation, right to water, right to housing, right to clothing, right to food, none of them have been implemented. 27 years is a long time. Very long time. And so Al-Jamaa is the party that now needs to co-govern, persuade other political parties to do the right thing. So now you will ask me, Al-Jamaa, some of our councillors will say, your president says down to service delivery. The most celebrated political analyst is Professor Stephen Friedman. He is professor of politics at the University of Johannesburg, a very progressive university and a progressive professor. Everyone wants to interview him. And he says in the democratic local government, only one qualification really matters. So I'm telling the Al-Jamaa councillors, if you can't meet that qualification, please give up, join another party, form your own party. We don't want you. We only want councillors, ward councillors, PR councillors, MMC members that will comply with what the professor has to say. And he says, only one qualification matters, being able to represent people effectively. Name one councillor, name one PR councillor, one ward councillor, one MMC that represent people effectively. We've got the first ones. We've got MMC Dapello and we've got Councillor Imran Mursa. But two is not enough. We need more and more councillors to represent people effectively. That's what the professor says. And he's not a nutty professor. He's a real professor. So we must listen to what the professor says. He goes further. Mayors and councillors don't manage the technical functions of councils. That's true. You're not allowed as a councillor to interfere with the technical functions of the council. If your electricity is off, you don't climb the pole and put it on. You'll suck to death. You get someone else to do it. You do oversight. The job of a councillor, a ward councillor, and a PR councillor is to make sure that they do it in a way that serves the citizens. But here, in all our 2,000 municipalities, you find a political party has a policy, they prepare a budget, and they tell the officials implement it and make sure that we can steal half the money. That's what's happening. That's not serving the people. The top-down approach is not the solution for South Africa. We must listen to the professor, that the representatives make sure that they do it in a way that serves the citizens. Professor Friedman further states that democracy is meant to be a system in which the people govern, and decision-making by the people is the core feature of democracy. But the decisions are made by the political party who's got the most seats. They then draw up a budget and they draw it up in such a way that half of the money gets into other people's pockets. That's why I told the previous Minister of Finance, we need zero budgeting. When I worked in Nestle, a Swiss company, when I worked in Mnet MultiChoice, a company on the stock exchange, the biggest company in South Africa, we did zero budgeting. The Minister of Finance, he embraced it, but he realized he doesn't make the cut, so he resigned. Because there was so much opposition to zero budgeting by the people who loot and steal and inflate prices and inflate tenders, that he couldn't take the heat and he had to resign. And now he is a backbencher in parliament like me. And the two of us, when the sixth parliament was elected, we went together up to the speaker and the judge to swear in that we will serve South Africa. The only way to serve South Africa is zero budgeting. And that is what Al Jamaa will do when it co-governs the five or six municipalities that we are eyeing. Professor goes on, if it is about service delivery, things happen to the people. Local government's role in a democracy is not to deliver to the people. You don't deliver houses, you don't deliver food parcels, you serve the people. You serve the people by holding what we call in Islam proper shura. And we had the leader of the shura council for Gauteng giving his support. The shura council, it's a Muslim council, but you know, they intermarry and it's everyone, it's all cultures, it's you know, it's a real community structure. The Shura Council of Gauteng must teach the concept of Shura consultation, because you don't deliver to the people, you serve them by consulting them, and they are the expert in understanding consulting, because it's a matter of their faith. They pray five times a day and they pledge that whatever they do, they will hold Shura and they will hold consultations with the people. So Al Jamaa is here to serve and not to be served. And we're not going to serve other people coming with trays. We're going to sit down with them and tell them, look, zero-based budgeting, a budget for every ward and later on for every voting station, for every rural village. Zero-based budgeting is, we don't add 10% to the budget that the beachy suburbs and the leafy suburbs got during the days of apartheid. Their budget was 100 times than the budget of suburbs in Soweto and in Mitchell's Plain. So every year they get 10%, so they just grow higher. No. We start from scratch. We go there and we try and bring equality amongst the wards, equality amongst the voting stations, and equality of the rural villages with these beachy suburbs and these leafy suburbs. Why must Mapami village near Umtata not have electricity, not have water? They are at the ocean. I went to the ocean, I put my feet in the ocean, and I caught 10 crayfish and we had it for breakfast. That beach, Mapami Beach, is so rich with fish. You just go there and you take whatever fish you want. But the only thing is they don't have the nice snook of Cape Town. When our people protest, the media describes it as service delivery protest and not reveal the real reasons why people are unhappy. What's wrong with the media? They are the 40th state or the 50th state. But they are perpetuating colonialism. They are perpetuating imperialism. They are promoting factionalism. They are promoting patriarchy. And it is a problem. People in informal settlements who protest the service deliveries, who have decided they, the people, have built their homes or shacks on the wrong place or area. Councillors must understand the role they play as service deliverers, and should be skilled and enable them to serve voters better by understanding what consultation means, what surah means. So this, they must know what are the people's needs and to serve them. Let me conclude, program director, and thank you for your patience. And I swear by now you've made up your mind. No, no, we must vote Al-Jamaah. We must tell our people to vote Al-Jamaah. Al-Jamaah is already an alternative in many areas to the PAC. When they come there, they think we're the PAC. And the reason is because we stick to the values of our forefathers. We stick to the values of Chief Albert Luthuli. Chief Albert Luthuli was a Nobel Peace winner. He was so respected in the world that Robert Kennedy flew, he was a presidential candidate in America. He flew with a helicopter to Groutville. His wife Ethel, she was scared of airplanes, but she accompanied him to help in the helicopter to show the respect for Chief Albert Luthuli. And what did Chief Albert Luthuli do to gain all that respect? He promoted not gender activism, fatherhood. He promoted fatherhood, which is in line with our Islamic values as well. The father, he used to have a meeting every day with the children, the daughter-in-laws, and the extended family. And he said, guys, how was your day? How did it go yesterday? What are you going to do tomorrow? How can we help one another? And he gave advice. That's the role of fathers. Absent fathers is a tactic by the colonialists to break up families. Gender, we want equality between men and women, but we feel women must get more rights than men. So we don't believe in gender equality. Al-Jamaah does not believe in gender equality because we feel the woman must have more rights than the men. And in that direction, we promote fatherhood. The father must be dragged into the family home and perform his role. Fathers who are not performing that role, we must use Ubuntu. We must use Ubuntu pressure to get fathers, because we have a situation where men don't maintain their wives. There's no food for the children to put on the table. Parliament has failed, Madam Speaker, if you listen. Parliament has failed women when it comes to maintenance. The lack of maintenance payments so that the child can have food on the table is worse than gender-based violence. So we are different to other political parties. They talk about gender-based violence, but they don't put the responsibility where it is. And that is what Chief Albert Luthuli put on the table. And so Al-Jamaah will push and will educate in the classrooms. We'll have textbooks. We want to make sure that the men and the boys and the young people in the Arabic language nafaka their women, maintain their women. I'm going to be very popular now because I'm going to say that women must chill out and relax at home, build their businesses, let the men carry out their responsibilities so women can be rich and they can start women empires and not do all the work, and then the men sit back and they do nothing. Noni Mukati says the people must have the balance of power. Now I apologize, I said that Al-Jamaah wants to have the balance of power in 5 municipalities. But Noni Mukati says the people must have the balance of power. So MMC councillor, we have to revisit that aspect of our manifesto. Advocate Samima, you are the legal eagles. Noni Makati says, parties must not have the balance of power. The people must have the balance of power. And she quotes a Chinese activist, Tsai Ing-wen. He says, democracy is not just an election, it is our daily life. Serve deliver, achieve, as Elder Marco concludes the speech. Let it restate that it is committed to serve all communities loyally. Many political parties were born in a church, even the Communist Party. We were born in a mosque, but we are a platform for all communities. And we have 1,000 councillors in 7 provinces and in 30 or 40 municipalities, whereas the previous election we only had 50 candidate councillors. Our Jamaa has grown dramatically, but that doesn't help if you don't vote for the party. The viewers on the TV stations, the listeners on the radio stations, now is your chance to put an alternative government in place. Okay, we may not be the government because of numbers, but we want to co-govern. So give us the balance of power in inverted commas. We're going to transfer that balance of power to the people. Democracy is under fire in every ward Al Jamaa contests. So vote for Al Jamaa. We are the answer. We are the answer. We will get the job done better. We will not get the job done like the DA says. We will get it done better and better and better like we've been doing so far. So vote for Al Jamaa, a platform for all communities. You can make a difference in your ward and in your community. If you vote for Al Jamaa and build back, empower your future, vote for Al Jamaa. I thank you very much. And thank you for the media for supporting a small party. Where did you hear the media coming out to say the manifesto of a small party with the nation? So, viva the media, viva!
Viva!
Thank you very much.
All right, that's Al Jamaa leader Hanif Hendricks launching the party's municipal elections manifesto. The party formed in 2007 and has contested 2009, 2014 and the 2019 elections. Until 2019, the party had no elected representatives nationally or provincially. In 2019, they won first national representative and one seat in the Western Cape legislature. You heard him saying that he will be contesting the position of mayor of Cape Town. All right, well, that brings SA Today to an end today. That's it from me, Flo Ledwaba, and the rest of the team here at SA Today. Thanks very much for being with us. We're back with you tomorrow at 2 p.m. Do continue to stay tuned to SABC News and have yourself a lovely evening. And until tomorrow, take care. Cheers.